Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Redeemer Lutheran Church on this, the second Sunday in Advent. A few quick announcements before we begin our worship. This Friday is the last day to get those Christmas cookie orders in. There's information in the newsletter this month, but these cookies help support our youth. If you'd like to order a kit to make these Christmas sugar cookies, we need to get those ordered by this Friday. Also, this upcoming Sunday is the last day to order Christmas poinsettias. So a couple deadlines. If you're interested in participating, getting a poinsettia ordered, please do so within the next week. Christmas is quickly approaching, which means our kids have been busy putting together the annual program. They will have their practice, their first practice, this Wednesday at 6 p.m. Also, on Christmas Eve, we are wondering if anybody has any special musical abilities that would like to just make that night more special. So, kids, adults, could be singing, could be playing an instrument. If you've got some type of ability and you'd like to share that talent with the church on Christmas Eve, we'd love to have you participate. If you are wondering what that might be like, just please speak to Karna Dom after worship or ask me. Or think we'll probably do this before the Christmas Eve services. Christmas Eve services will hold at 4 p.m. and 6 p.m. 4 p.m. and 6 p.m. Also, you may notice on your way to church, we've got a couple Christmas trees up. We've got our beautiful one up here. But we also have our annual giving tree. This year we are giving to some families here in the community. We're hoping to gather some coats, gather some gift cards, some toiletries, a number of different items, and we'll be giving those directly to some families that are a little bit more in need here in our community. So please, on your way home, you'll notice on the giving tree out there, there's little tags. All the different tags have different items that are needed. So grab one, grab a couple, shop, and then be sure to have those here to church no later than December 15th, so that we can get those tubs filled up with the different items that we're gathering for those people in need. That is the announcements that I have this morning. The Johnson family is going to be lighting our Advent wreath this morning. So Will and Steph and family, if you could come forward to light our Advent wreath. And as they do, let us sing verses 1 and 2 of Light One Candle to Watch for Messiah.
That passes us all understanding.
Amen.
Amen.
Reading from Luke's Gospel, the first chapter. In the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah, who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Both of them were righteous in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commands and decrees blamelessly. But they were childless because Elizabeth was not able to conceive, and they were both very old. When Zechariah's division was on duty, and he was serving as priest before God, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And when the time for the burning of the incense came, all the assembled worshipers were praying outside. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God. And he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the parents to their children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah was, or asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I'm an old man, and my wife is well along in years." The angel said to him, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God. I have been sent to speak to you and tell you this good news. And now you will be silent, and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their appointed time." Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he was taking so long in the temple. When he came out, he could not speak to them. They realized he had seen a vision in the temple, for he kept making signs to them but remained unable to speak. When this time of service was completed, he returned home. After this, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant and for 5 months remained in seclusion. "The Lord has done this for me," she said. "In these days, he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
We'll read responsibly Bible reading from Luke 1, chapters 46 through 55. Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord,
and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior.
For he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed.
For the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name.
His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation.
He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts.
He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble.
He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty.
He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful
to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors."
Thank you, Chad. This time I'll ask any boys or girls that might be in church to come on up for our children's message. And as you do, please collect our penny options. So come on up, kiddos. Christmas. How many lights do we have lit on our Advent wreath this morning. How many more do we have to light?
Three.
Three more. So next Sunday we'll light three. 2 weeks from today we'll light four blue ones. And on Christmas Eve we'll light the middle one as we celebrate that Jesus is born. So we're getting closer. Today I want to ask you, how do you show somebody that you love them? How do you do that? How do you show them your love? Say a little bit louder. Give them a hug. That's very, very good. How else can you show somebody that you love them? You can tell them. What about, how else do you show your love? Praying to Jesus. I really like them. Now, Carter said to give them a hug. I like that. But what if they're like a long ways away? How could you tell them that you love them then? Yeah, how do you do it then? You can send them a text. Yeah, that's right. 2021, send them a text. I love you. That works. How else can you tell somebody? FaceTime them. Yep, these are our kids, the digital age right here. But you're right, text and FaceTime. Yeah, that's a good way too. Let me teach, I'm going to teach all of you how to show somebody that you love them when they're far away, okay? So I want you to see somebody in the church. It might be a mom or a dad or a grandparent. I'm going to teach you how to show them that you love them. It's called blowing them a kiss. Have you ever done this before? Here's how you do it. Everybody, kiss your hand. Then you pull it out like this, and you blow it. All right, stand up. I want you to look at the person that you love in the church. And we're going to blow them a kiss, all right? Ready? Everybody stand up. Go like this. Mwah! Look at them. Blow them your kiss. Catch it? Everybody catch that? You got to catch it. All right, sit back down. Very, very good. Now, the reason I'm talking about this is that God wants to show us that He loves us, too. Now, how does God do that? How does God show us that He loves us? Can He send us a text? What do you think?
No.
Can He FaceTime us?
No.
You know what God can do, though? God kind of like blew us a kiss. Know that? And I brought some Hershey Kisses with me. And when God wanted to show us He loves us, He didn't send us a text. He didn't FaceTime us, but He did send us something. Do you know what God sent us? What did God send us? Yeah. He sent us kind of a kiss in the form of, can you see behind me? What's in the manger? You stand up there, look at, there's an angel there. Who else is in the manger? Yes. Jesus. There's Joseph and Mary, but there's also baby Jesus. And baby Jesus was God's way, because God's, He's a long ways away, right? Where's God at? He's in heaven. But He wanted to blow us a kiss, and He did that by sending us Jesus. And so He sent us Jesus from heaven to tell us and to teach us that He loves us. Alright? So on your way back, I want you to grab a kiss. All right, this is going to remind us that chocolate's good, but more than that, the kiss that God blew us, Jesus born in the manger. All right, let's fold our hands, and please repeat after me. Everybody say,
Dear God,
thank you, thank you, thank you,
thank you, thank you, thank you,
for your love,
that you sent to us
when Jesus was born.
In the manger.
And please help us
to love
just like you do.
In Jesus' name,
amen. All right, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to practice. I'm going to throw these, right? So we're talking about throwing kisses. Once you catch one, you can go back to your seats. You want one?
Yeah.
according to St. Luke, the first chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. For why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that the Lord would fulfill his promises to her." Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please remain standing as we sing Go Tell It on the Mountain.
Not good. We're not off to a very good start. Well, were
you were at least generous. Did you give to the poor? Did you give to those people that were in most need? And once again, the man was scratching his head and said, no, you know, I really didn't give money to those in need either. And again, Peter looked at this man and then just shook his head. This is not good. You know, we're not off to a very good start. Well, did you at least do good things? Did you do good deeds? Did you help out your fellow man? Did you maybe, you know, help an elderly person cross the street? You know, did you do anything good in your life? And once again, the man shook his head and said, you know, I was mostly just in it for myself and in life. And Peter looked at the man and said, you got to help me out, all right? You got to give me something. Tell me at least one good thing that you did in your life. There's got to be at least one good thing. And the man said, well, there was this time. I was out Christmas shopping. And all of a sudden I saw this group, this biker gang, surround an elderly woman. And this biker gang, they were mean and they began to pick on her. They tried to steal her purse. And it just angered me. And so I threw down my shopping bags. I ran into the middle of this group. And I confronted them. I told them how cowardly they were. And I found the biggest, baddest biker there. I looked him in the face and I said, you are a coward. And I spat right in his face. And Peter said, wow, that is really impressive. When did this happen? The man said, oh, about 10 minutes ago. Grace and peace to you from God the Father and from our Lord and from our Savior Jesus, who is in Christ. Amen. Today is week number 3 of our Christmas sermon series that we are calling The Road to Bethlehem. And my hope in these weeks that we've been diving deeper into the Bible is that we would really learn more about Christmas, that we learn more about this gift that God has given to us. Because I think a lot of things that we feel we know about Christmas come from, you know, different places that aren't always scriptural. We think we know what Christmas was like, but you know, my hope really is that when we focus on these things, we better understand actually what happened. That we can better appreciate what God did in our world. Week number 1, we looked at Mary, and we talked about, she was likely a very young woman. You know, women back in biblical times got married much younger than they do today. And Mary lived in Nazareth, and this is significant, because Nazareth was a small town, and just a tiny town, really, 200 people, maybe 300 people, that most people thought nothing good could happen in Nazareth, but God is the type of God who takes those people and those places and uses them, lifts them up, and God chose Mary to be the mother of the Savior. Last week we looked at Joseph, Jesus' earthly dad. And of all the people we're going to discuss during this series, Joseph we really know least about. Because believe it or not, the earthly father of Jesus does not have one word recorded in all of Scripture. Joseph never says a word in Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John. And because we know so little about him, different traditions, different customs have arose trying to explain who he was. Now, last week I challenged you, if you have a nativity set at home, to go and take a look at your Joseph. Because there's one of two different ways that people have seen Joseph. Either he was young, you know, a little bit older than Mary, or he was very elderly. And this is Roman Catholic view, that Joseph was very elderly, and that he and Mary never consummated their marriage. And there's these two different views. Now, my view is that Joseph was probably very young, just like Mary, just because it makes the most sense. And I don't think we need to take that jump to say that Mary and Joseph never consummated their marriage. I just don't think scripturally or faith-wise we need to make that leap. Today, we return back to Mary. 2 weeks ago, we left her right after the angel Gabriel dropped the news on her that she would be the mother of the Messiah. And I remember she was likely very, very young, maybe 14, maybe 15 years old. She was engaged to this man named Joseph, And she had probably plans for her life, but at this moment, once Gabriel comes into her life, it's a blessing, but these blessings come with some complications as well. She and Joseph are not married yet. Further, who can she tell this good news to? After Gabriel comes and pronounces that she would be the mother of the Messiah, do you think she could tell her friends this? Put yourself in her shoes. God tells you that he's going to do some type of miracle in your life, some type of just extraordinary thing. Would you be able to tell a friend? Do you think Mary shared this with her friends? Say, ladies, you know, you won't believe it. I'm pregnant, and it's from God. I don't think she did that, because I don't think they would have believed her. What about her parents? Do you think Mary went, Mom and Dad, God's doing something amazing in my life? I don't know if she did that either. And it's not that she didn't have a good relationship with her mom and dad, but that they believed her. Now, Scripture tells us that Mary does go and share this news with one person. And that one person is her aunt. It's her aunt Elizabeth. As Mary is trying to ponder, okay, who do I share this news with? I'm sure she remembered that Gabriel shared with her that God had worked another miracle in her aunt Elizabeth's life. Elizabeth was an elderly woman. Her husband was also elderly, and they lived in a small town named Ein Karim was down close to Jerusalem, and Zechariah was a priest, type of pastor back in Jesus' time. But they are both elderly, and they weren't able to have any children whatsoever, but God allowed Elizabeth to get pregnant. And Gabriel shares this news with Mary that Elizabeth has been pregnant for 6 months. And I picture when Mary hears this news, she realizes that there is one person who would believe her, who would believe that God was working a miracle in her, and that was her aunt Elizabeth. And so Scripture tells us that Mary leaves in haste. I love this word. Leaves in haste, leaves in a hurry. Doesn't take a whole lot of time, and she travels about 80 miles from Nazareth in the northern country down to Ein Karim, where her aunt Elizabeth lives. Now, why would she do this? I think she did this because she needed somebody in her life. She needed somebody to believe in her. I think she did this because she needed a mentor. She needed somebody in her life to lift her up, to listen to her, to celebrate what was going on in her life in that moment. Now, this child that Elizabeth will bring into this world is another significant person. This is John the Baptist. This is the man who will help prepare the world for the coming of Christ. And so Elizabeth and Mary get together and they celebrate. And Scripture, it's just one verse, and a lot of times people kind of read over this and don't really stop and think of the significance, but the Bible tells us that Mary will spend three months with her aunt Elizabeth. Now, why would she spend so much time there? Well, we know she's probably there to help her aunt through the end of her pregnancy, but even more than that, Joseph, remember where Joseph lives? He's from Bethlehem, and Bethlehem is close to Ein Karim. And so I picture, as Mary travels those 80 miles, those hard 80 miles, trying to figure out, God is giving a blessing in my life, but it's something that's hard to believe. And so I'm convinced that as Mary is visiting her Aunt Elizabeth, she also shares this good news with her fiancé, Joseph. And the two begin to plan that their life is now going to be different, but it's going to be a blessing. It's going to be a good life. And she spends these 3 months with Elizabeth. Now, what type of lesson does that teach us? I think that we also need people in our lives that are mentors. People in our lives that maybe aren't family members, but people that have gone through things that we're going through. I think of our confirmation program. Something that we do for every one of our confirmation youth is to assign them a mentor here in the church. And there's a few requirements. That mentor cannot be a family member, but it's someone that's grounded in this faith. It's someone who's who's lived this faith, who's gone through the highs and the lows of trying to walk this Christian faith before them. I think of teammates. Here at Loganview, the teammates program is very, very strong in those that have either had a mentor through this or those that have mentored you. Talk about just what a joy it is to walk with young people as they grow and they learn what life is as well. And so my suggestion for you is to, you know, find those people that you can be a mentor to. Find those people that, you know, trying to make it in this world, that are trying to figure out what it means to be a good person, to grow in this faith. And so today, we thank God for Elizabeth. We thank God for Zechariah. We thank God that she could be a mentor during this really difficult time for Mary, that as Mary went and shared this good news, that she had someone there that believed her, because God was also working a miracle in her life as well. Amen? Our worship continues this morning as we confess the Christian faith that we hold in common using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. This time I'll ask one of our ushers to bring forward this morning's offering. And as they do, please sing with me, "We Are an Offering." And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven. We praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
Sunday, 5 p.m. Christmas caroling. It's going to be a blast, so please join us. Also, stick around for coffee and donuts in the fellowship hall afterwards. The adult Bible study this morning in the parlor, we'll be taking a deeper look at Mary and Elizabeth and Ein Kerem, the town that Elizabeth lived in. So we'd love for you to join us as well. Grab the coffee, grab the donut, and just join us in the parlor this morning. But here now, our final blessing. The God of hope, fill us with all joy and peace in believing, so that we may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit, through Christ Jesus, for whom we wait. Amen. Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.